Good morning, everyone. Let us do the usual check of audio and video, please. If you could answer on the chat to make sure that everything is fine. Okay, thank you very much. So, as usual, if there are questions on what we saw last time, please write them on the chat. I received several by email and I answered by email. So let us wait another 5 minutes before starting. Again, please, if you have questions on the important, very important demo with the MATLAB code that we made last time, please ask on the chat. And I hope that many of you try to play with the code and analyzed how it was built, because that's the essence and the core of the design of every telecom system, satellite telecom system. That's the ultimate ultimate quantities. It presents the ultimate quantities that are used to design the link, the radio link. Okay, I think we can start. So I tried to separate the two channels, the one from Space Environment from the one on Space Mission and Systems. And my attempt failed in spite of half an hour of effort, and my frustration was well caught in a video and audio that some of you distributed. It's not something I'm proud of, but I made every attempt. So now we have to go with this single channel. I hope it will not be a problem. So you will have to connect when you see a live video, just connect to it. Some other important information about the exams. The exams, as I said, in June will be made only online. I have a session on July 3rd and July, another one on July 24, which will be partly online and partly in presence. I'm thinking to do the multiple choice test online in every case. And do as much as possible, as many as possible of the oral exams in presence, okay, and not online. Because online is a big complication, big loss of time for all of you, because essentially you have to stay for almost an entire day waiting to be examined. If, as I expect, there will be many students who will sign up for that exam. I checked yesterday, I think I saw more than 30 people, and I'm pretty sure that on June 3rd, we will have 50 people as 50 students as usual, which means with the online exams at least 3 days. So it will be a rather big complication. In July, I really hope to have most or at least a significant part of the exams done in presence. You know that you need two video devices for attending the exam, and you have to send to me your ID prior to the exam for identification. And the identification will be done one by one personally, it will not be in a public room. We will do it according to the instruction that I posted online. So also the identification of the students will be a complicated matter and a lengthy matter. So I hope in July at least to have a significant fraction of the exams done in presence. All right, let us start and go on with the topics of the course. There are a few things that I didn't mention in the past lectures and that are absolutely necessary. One is the effect of polarization. Polarization, as you know, is a property of an electromagnetic wave which concerns the orientation in space of the electric and magnetic field with respect to the wave vector. And let me grab the pen. So if we have a wave vector K, which defines the propagation direction of the energy flux, we know that the electric and magnetic field B are orthogonal to each other and orthogonal to the wave vector. So K dot E is equal to K dot B is equal to E dot B and is equal to zero. However, the electric field in general, the orientation of the wave vector of the electric field and magnetic field in space with respect to the wave vector is not fixed. The electric field can rotate, and similarly can do the magnetic field. And in this case, we speak of circular polarization. Or the electric field and the magnetic field can stay in a fixed direction in space. In which case we speak of linear polarization. And so, for example, if this is the wave vector which comes out of the plane of the computer, I design the electric field E here, for example. The electric field in a circular polarization can rotate along a circle in this direction or in the other direction. In this direction, here we speak of left-hand circular polarization. In the opposite direction, when the field rotates clockwise, we speak of right-hand circular polarization. If we refer to linear polarization, a vector which stays fixed along this direction, we can conventionally call it vertical polarization. So the wave would be vertically polarized, and this direction horizontal polarization. In space telecommunication, almost invariably one uses a circular polarization. And circular polarization is especially useful because it doesn't require a special orientation between the ground antenna and the spacecraft antenna. If the spacecraft antenna were transmitting, for example, in a polarization along this axis, and the ground antenna would receive on a polarization, on this linear polarization, the signal at the output of the feed would be a perfect zero. So vertical polarization is used, may be used either the receiving or the transmitting antenna, but one of the two antenna has to be able to receive or transmit in both in circular polarization. So circular polarization, however, is preferred because if the receiver can receive a circular polarization and the antenna electric field has the same polarization, so rotating the same way, at the output of the feed, you have a signal. Of course, the signal would be strongly suppressed if the spacecraft antenna transmits in one polarization and the receiving antenna feed is set up to receive the opposite polarization, for example, left and right. In this case, the output would be a zero, a perfect zero in terms of voltage. So you have to make sure that the polarization of the transmitting and receiving antenna match. It's important because polarization provides also a very important and interesting way to separate signals. Suppose that you want to transmit at a given frequency. You have the possibility to transmit two polarization, left or right, left circular or right circular, at the same time, and code different information on the two polarizations. So you have essentially for the same channel, you have, so for the same frequency assignment, frequency allocation, you have the possibility to transmit two streams of data, and this is very useful and very important. This capability is used normally for terrestrial satellites, much less so or never for deep space communications where one wants to increase the power, the available transmitting power on a single channel. When power is scarce, you don't make use of frequency reuse made possible by polarization. So this is the first thing that I wanted to mention. We have seen this part. I added in the slides that I will upload today after this class some additional definition on the feed or illuminator. And you see here an example of a feed of an antenna. This feed can be used to a relatively large with a relatively large antenna, but the feed, and this is important, must be seen as a transducer. In the receiving chain, it transforms the electric field and electromagnetic power received from space and focused by the antenna dish into an electric signal, a voltage. And this can be picked up, for example, by a coaxial cable. You see, this is the terminal of a coaxial cable. And the feed, properly configured, can provide both polarizations. In the transmitting chain, it does the opposite. It transforms as a transducer the voltage coming from a coaxial cable or a waveguide into an electromagnetic field, which illuminates the reflector dish for transmission to space. So the feed is very important, and it's let us say its center, I should say its face center, is located in the focus of the antenna, whether it is the prime focus or the Cassegrain focus, or as in a beam waveguide antenna, the focus in the basement of the antenna. In the okay, so see the feed as a transducer. It's called also feed horn, and since it's an antenna, it can be used on board as a low gain antenna. Of course, the directivity is large. If you think at a feed mounted on the prime focus of an antenna, for example, here, the feed which receives the signal, this is can be the mast, can be the tripod. So it receives the signal from the transmitter. The feed illuminates the antenna, all the antenna. And sometimes there is also some spillover. It cannot be precise because the antenna diagram, as we have seen from physical optics, has side lobes, so there will be some spillover of radiation beyond the limits of the dish. It illuminates the dish and retransmit to space. Okay? But since its aperture is very broad, it can be used on board the spacecraft as a low gain antenna because the aperture angle can be large, can be 50 degrees, 60 degrees. So it may provide emergency communications with the spacecraft. And therefore, on board, we have low gain antennas which are generally horn antennas. And here I've added all these concepts. Let us move on. These are things that we saw already. So let us move on to this important part. So how do we manage? How does the ground antenna handles the signal that is received, for example? Remember that the received signal can be extremely weak, especially for deep space communications. The signal is incredibly weak. We are speaking of 10 to the minus 18 watts. So, handling such a signal is complicated, and we will see how it's done. But before doing so, we need to introduce the basic concepts of down conversion and up conversion. Imagine a signal received at one of the microwave frequencies used in space telecommunications. For example, let us focus on X-band, 8.4 GHz. This signal is collected by the reflector, focused on the feed, and then transformed in a weak electric signal. This weak electric signal needs to be amplified, and we will see what is the element that does that. However, in order to handle the telemetry stream and to make Doppler or range measurements possible, The first thing that the ground antenna does is to down convert to frequencies that are more manageable. Today, the analog signal, 8.4 gigahertz, cannot be digitized and transformed into a digital stream of electric field samples or voltage samples at that frequency. The electronics would be very expensive. So the first thing that one does is to convert coherently the sky frequency, and when we speak of sky frequency, we speak of the frequency of the signal received at the antenna, sky frequency. We down convert it to a lower frequency, which is more manageable. And this is done by using two elements. And you can see here the two elements. So, imagine to have a frequency coming from the sky, from the spacecraft, at frequency omega zero. This is called omega zero. And mix it with another frequency, a signal of another frequency, which we can call omega reference. I call it omega reference. I don't see what it's hard to read what is here. Let us call omega reference. This omega reference is generated by the ground antenna. And the mixer, the symbol of the mixer is this circle with an X. The mixer multiplies the two signals. So suppose that, let us call it omega, because I see that in the equations I used omega, I used F. What the mixer does is multiply the incoming signal, and let me change this. This is omega zero. Take the pen, I want to be consistent with what is on the slides. Now, in order not to make confusion. Okay. So, this is the frequency F. And this is the frequency F0, which comes from the ground antenna. So the incoming signal would be cosine 2 pi ft plus phi. Phi is a phase, the phase of the signal, received signal. And F, remember, is changing with time. F is not a constant. If we multiply this by cosine 2 pi f0 t and use the usual trigonometric formulas, we see that we produce two frequencies. One is the difference between the incoming frequencies and the reference frequency f0, and the other is the sum of the two. So we have not done anything but using the trigonometric formulas, the one that I generally write on the first page of some books of frequency consultation. So, spectral-wise, we have transformed the incoming signal. Let us see what happens in the Fourier space. This is the frequency axis, we have a signal, this is zero. We have a signal, let us say here, f. We have another signal here, f0. And what we did after the mixer, that is here at this location, after the mixer, was to obtain a line which is 1/2 in terms of amplitude of the original line, and at a frequency f0 minus f, and then another line up here at a frequency f plus f0. So we have shifted in frequency the signal. Okay? So we have obtained a frequency shift of the signal. If after the mixer we put a bandpass filter, then the bandpass filter in Fourier space cuts everything which is beyond a certain frequency. I made it a bit too wide. A bandpass filter that matters to us would be something of this kind. Okay? So we want to retain only the lower frequency. So at the output of the bandpass filter, we have only the frequency f minus f0 or f0 minus f. Okay? We are in the real domain. You see that with this trick, we can move the received signal, preserving the phase coherence, because you see that the phase is preserved, wherever we want in the frequency domain. And this can be done and repeated several times. We can have a first down conversion stage, okay, to be followed by a second down conversion stage, until we bring the received signal, we shift the received signal or push it in a frequency range where we can handle it easily. In the past, this was done by pushing the signal in the megahertz range or even below. So from 8.4 gigahertz, we could go down, we went down to frequencies of the order of 1 megahertz or so. But we are free to do it. And you can imagine that if the mixing frequency, this one, is variable, we can attain also an interesting result, because in principle we can have a frequency at the output which is exactly zero. Zero means that we have a DC voltage, and this is done when we need to make Doppler or range rate measurements. Remember this. One important point is that everything must be coherent. So the reference source for the mixing, this one and this one, must be the same. They must be coherent. Because if you use a frequency standard to do one mixing and another frequency standard for the other mixing, you, of course, lose completely the phase of the incoming signal. So coherency is important. You see depicted in Fourier space these concepts in this last diagram. Of course, we have seen this in the down conversion stage. So we have assumed to use a low pass filter here. But if you start from a low frequency and use rather than a low pass filter or a band pass filter, you use a high pass filter or a filter which allows the upper frequency to pass, then you have obtained the opposite of the down conversion. You have obtained an up conversion. So you move the frequency at a higher value. Of course, the second mode, the up conversion, is used in the transmitting chain. So let me know if you have questions on this simple but important concept. And now let us look at the architecture, the global architecture of a ground antenna. So this block diagram, the block diagram that you see here, I modified it slightly, adding a few more comments that I generally made in class, but in this case I put them on the slide. These are the building blocks of a ground antenna. So let us analyze what happens, how the incoming signal, the received sky frequency, is treated. So we have the incoming signal here. I could have made the arrow a little bit more marked. I will increase the size of the head of the arrow. So we know that is reflected by the dish. The dish reflects everything and concentrates the power on the feed. And the feed transforms these electromagnetic waves into a voltage. It's a tiny voltage. The first thing that we have to do is to amplify the voltage by means of a low noise amplifier, also called the front end. The front end, because these are two words, front end. It's the first thing that the first active electronic device that the signal sees. The goal of the low noise amplifier is to catch the tiny voltage and bring it to a value which is manageable. So it increases the voltage of the signal at its output without doing anything to the frequency. So if the incoming signal were X-band, at the output the frequency would be 8.4 GHz, Ka-band would be 32.5 GHz, and so on. Let us call this frequency F, which is the same as the sky frequency. The first thing that is done after the amplification, and remember, the amplifier, the low noise amplifier, is attached to the feed, must be as close as possible to the feed in order to avoid losses. Because when you have a high frequency signal, it's very easy to have losses. The first thing that is being done, again, very close, physically very close to the output of the LNA, is a down conversion stage. So we have a signal called the local oscillator 1 frequency. LO stands for local oscillator. And we will see where this frequency comes from. We have a mixing stage, a first mixer, followed by a low pass filter. So remember, when we are here, if this is F, we call it F1. Here we have a frequency F1 minus F, or F minus F1, and F1 plus F. So we have both frequencies. But the low pass filter, which follows the mixing stage, allows only one frequency to go through. So the frequency after this first mixing stage would be F minus the frequency of the first local oscillator. So we have obtained a first down conversion stage. Then, in the implementation that I outlined here in this sketch, there are also different implementations with the three mixing stage, only one mixing stage, etc. It depends. We have a second down conversion stage with a frequency called LO2, local oscillator 2. Again, we have a mixer followed by a low pass filter. So the mixer, the low pass filter. And here we have a frequency, which is if at the input we have F minus LO1, here we would have F minus LO1, which was the input, decreased further by the frequency LO2. And this can be as low as we wish. It can be 1 MHz, can be more for special purposes, can be 100 MHz. Digitizing a 100 MHz signal is not complicated today. But we can also go to near zero, almost zero frequency, as it's done when we do Doppler measurements. But let us say something in the megahertz range. And finally, we have the receiver, called also back-end. The back-end receiver, which is the last step. The receiver does the decoding of the telemetry. So what we saw last times on Thursday was exactly that, the one of the tasks that the receiver does. It works with a low frequency residual carrier and decodes the telemetry stream. This is called back-end, to be opposed to the front-end, which is the other amplifier, the amplifier that we have right after the feed. So we speak of front-end amplifier and back-end receiver. Sometimes the low noise amplifier is also called receiver, but is an inappropriate name, is an amplifier, the front-end amplifier. Now, a word, important word, on the source of the mixing frequencies of LO1 and LO2. So the source of all these frequencies is the master frequency standard of the station. And the master frequency standard is a clock, a very stable clock in general, good antennas use hydrogen masers, so therefore clocks which have a very high stability over time scales between 1,000 and 10,000 seconds. And this output frequency, F0 for typical hydrogen masers can be 5 megahertz, so pretty low, but is in the megahertz range, depending on the hydrogen maser can be 5, 10 megahertz or something similar. So low frequency, but very stable. This frequency is distributed everywhere to all the subsystems that needs it. For example, to generate the LO1, which in many implementations, for example, the VLBI implementation, LO1 is 8.080, is fixed, 0.8 gigahertz, LO1. So to go from 5 megahertz to 8.08 gigahertz, one needs an up converter. So it's a device which up converts the frequency F0. Sometimes there are more than one up conversion stage, and bring it to the required frequency. Okay, so the signal goes out here, is up converted and brought to a suitable frequency for the first mixing stage. In the second mixing stage, we do the same. So we have the frequency F0, 5 MHz, for example. And now the up converter needs not so the multiplication factor must be not so high. And we produce the frequency LO2. The frequency LO2 sometimes can be controlled electronically in order to match the desired value by the receiver, an optimal value for the receiver. So for example, if we have 8.4 gigahertz here, we have mix it with the 8.08 GHz at the output of the first down conversion stage, we have 320 MHz. And here, if LO2 is equal, for example, 315 MHz, here we have just 5 MHz. So the frequency that the receiver can handle very easily. In the uplink chain, so let us move on the right-hand side of this diagram, we do just the opposite. We have to start from a low frequency, 5 MHz for example, and upconvert it to 7.2 GHz, which is the uplink frequency. How do we do it? First, we start with the signal coming from the master frequency standard of the ground antenna. This signal goes into an exciter, which increases, actually modulates it, accepts a modulation and also a first increase in frequency, and then we do the same. So we have the modulated signal here at the output of the exciter, which is described in the following slides. We go through a bandpass filter, and this time we cut the low frequency and let the sum of the two frequencies pass. So if the frequency of the signal here is up one, here we would have F0 plus up one. Then we do go through a second up conversion stage, again a bandpass filter, and we end up with a frequency that after this up conversion stage is the transmitted frequency 7.2. So in this case we have increased the frequency again by a multiplication chain, changing only the characteristics of the filter. Instead of using a low pass filter, we use a band pass filter or a high pass filter. High pass filter to let the higher frequency go through. So I see that it's 11, so we'll make a break here, 15 minutes, and we will reconvene afterwards at 11:15, but I see some questions. But if we half the signal several times, doesn't the signal become too weak? The answer is no, because remember that the formula, perhaps you refer to the formula here, where there was this factor 1/2, okay? But this factor 1/2 was simply due to the fact that the incoming signal and the bit signal were identical, had amplitude unity. But if you put here A1 or A received, and here you put another amplitude factor, which is A mix, okay, or A L O 1, this amplitude can be quite large, so the signal does not become too weak. So I hope this is what you mentioned. All right, let me please answer on the slide if this is what you meant with your question. Then there is another one. Wouldn't a single mixer be enough to bring the frequency of the signal at every frequency? Why do we use two? In principle, you are right. We can use only one down conversion stage, but it's impractical because the fine control of the frequency is possible only if the mixing frequency is sufficiently low. It's difficult to do it at 8.4 gigahertz. So for practical reasons, one prefers to use more down conversion stages. For example, in VLBI antennas, there is a fixed down conversion stage at 80 megahertz, followed by a tunable second mixing stage. So it's only for practical reasons. It's complicated to handle a 32 gigahertz frequency and an 8.4 gigahertz frequency by changing it finely, okay? Take into account that the incoming signal is also changing its frequency with time. Then there is another question. Also, the frequencies of the mixer must be the same. No, you mean the frequencies LO1 and LO2? No, no. LO1 and LO2 must be different, of course, cannot be the same, because the first big down conversion is done with the first local oscillator, the first local oscillator. The second uses a different frequency. Okay, so so this is a question on the dates of the exam. I never said 4 and 23rd of June. No, I think on InfoStud they are June 3rd and June 3rd, June 3 and June 19. In July there is an exam date is July 3rd. And then another one, the 24th. So let me write June 3 and 19, July. Let me check on the calendar. I think it's 3rd. Yes, which is a Friday, July 3rd and 24. So there is a question now on the power. I said 10 to the minus 18 watt for a received signal, but in watts over square meters, how much density of power does arrive from the spacecraft? Well, you can do the computation. It depends on how big the antenna is. If you use a 30, let us say 30 meter antenna, the flux density, 30 meter antenna means, I write it here, 30 meter is 3 times 10 square. This is the diameter square. divided by, multiplied by pi over 4. I want to compute the area, so this is roughly 1000, and this is roughly unity, is about 10 to the 3 square meter. Okay? So you can compute the power flux density, which is 10 to the minus 21 watts per square meter. Okay? It's tiny. And this tells you how difficult is the task of the low noise amplifiers. So another question about the exams. We have to see. It depends on how many of you will sign up for the exam. For this reason, I close the possibility to sign up to the exams a few days before the actual exam date. And I don't know in this case when the possibility to sign up closes. Once we have a clear picture of how many people in both space environment and space missions and systems are interested in taking the exam, then we will provide a calendar for the exams, which will be necessarily over more than one day. Remember, however, one important thing that is written also on my website, and there will be only one multiple choice test per month. So if you are interested, if you have not passed the homeworks, and you are interested in taking the exam in June, you need to take either June 3rd or June 19. You need to take the multiple choice test on June 3rd. There is only one possibility, one multiple choice test per month. Okay, that was clearly stated everywhere on my website and on GOMP. So this must be clear. I hope you knew that. Please confirm. Okay. So another 3 minutes and we will restart. I will get a cup of coffee and we'll be back soon. Okay, we are ready to restart. In this diagram, there are two important, let us say, all elements are important, but the functions that let us say are more perhaps critical for mission operations are the receiver, which starts from a relatively low frequency signal of a few megahertz and demodulates it. I'm saying a few megahertz, but remember it depends on the type of missions. For terrestrial missions, where the bandwidths are very large, can be a higher frequency, of course. So we decode the telemetry at the receiver and carry out also the so-called radiometric measurements, Doppler, range rate, range, and delta DOR, on which we will focus tomorrow. Then we have the group exciter modulator, which is used, these two elements, which are described later, encode the commands, the uplink commands. So they stay at the bottom of the chain, respectively of the receiving chain and the transmitting chain. So this is an example of how is configured a typical ESA ground station. I would not go into the detail. And here I added, for your benefit, the functions. I described the functions of some of these modules. For example, in the transmitting chain, we have the exciter, which essentially provides the uplink carrier and accepts modulation for both ranging and commanding. Then we have the modulator, which tells how to modulate the carrier for ranging and telecommands. And finally, there is the high power amplifier, which I forgot to spend a few words on in the previous slide, which is this guy here, which is the last stage. So we have up converted the signal, but of course we need to make sure that significant flux density arrives at the spacecraft. And therefore we have to amplify the signal as much as possible, as required by the mission design. This high power amplifier can be, these are devices that are typically klystrons if powers of the order of 24-20 kilowatts are required. The Deep Space Network has the possibility for emergency situation to transmit a test band 400 watts. Sorry, 400 kilowatts of power. Okay, so this we are in the range of kilowatts. And for most applications in deep space, one uses really this high power amplifier due to the large space loss. Okay. Actually, it's not 400 kilowatts, it's 500 kilowatts. I remember 400, I will check. Anyway, typical frequencies at X band are 420 kilowatts. At Ka band, it's difficult to obtain such large power, but the antenna directivity is much better, of course. And current amplifier reach powers on the order of 500 watts, 800 watts. These are typical powers of the high power amplifier at Ka band. Okay. Now are in development also solid state high power amplifier. And the way in which they are done is combining together the output of many small elements, each providing an output power of 1 or 2 watts, combining them together in a phase coherent way. If you combine several elements of 1 watt and you are able to do it coherently, then you can easily make a 1 kilowatt high power amplifier. And the advantage is, of course, that if one of the elements breaks, you lose a little bit of power, but in the end, the whole high power amplifier still works. So also from the point of view of reliability, it would be highly desirable. This is the new trend in high power amplifiers at ground stations. In the receiving chain, we have described everything, and for your reference, you have this slide. But let us concentrate on the need. On an important aspect of the ground antenna, which has to do with the need of cryogenically cooled low noise amplifier. Why do we need low noise? Well, low noise we know because every amplifier adds some noise produced of its own. So we have the incoming signal, and the incoming signal this is the LNA. This is the signal coming from the feed. The LNA has the task of amplifying the signal. If we call S, the signal which is received from the feed, the amplifier will produce a signal which has an amplitude GS, where actually I should say square root of G is imprecise, square root of GS, because G refers, which is the gain, refers to the power. Anyway, an amplified replica of the incoming signal. The characteristic of the amplifier is its gain. So if we have a power P in the output, we have a power P out, which is equal to GP in. Okay, and this is why I wrote square root of G, if S is a voltage. Unfortunately, the amplifier generates some noise. Is an active device and it has some intrinsic noise. Okay, some intrinsic noise. And the internally generated noise, let us call it ND, N of the device. And this noise is spread, of course, over a bandwidth B. So, what would be the noise at the output here? We have to sum. Suppose that the input signal has a noise corresponds, has a noise power corresponding to the system noise temperature TS. Okay? So this is TS, we multiply by the Boltzmann constant and the bandwidth B and obtain the equivalent noise power at the input of the amplifier. Then we multiply it by G, the gain. So if we want the noise N at the output, we multiply the input noise, which is this, by the gain G, and we have to add the noise of the device, the intrinsic noise. Remember, the low noise amplifier amplifies the signal, but amplifies also the input noise, which is KTS times B. So if we rewrite that equation by putting GKB outside the bracket, we have here TS and another term, which is ND divided by GKB, which has the dimensions of a temperature. We call it TE, and this is the equivalent noise temperature of the device. And a good device, of course, is one which has a very low equivalent noise temperature, which derives from a low ND. So in the output, we will have a noise which is GKB plus multiplied by the sum of the two temperatures, TS plus TE. And this quantity is called the system noise temperature of the device. Okay? In order, what we want is that TE is as low as possible, which means ND as small as possible. And making ND as small as possible, as we have understood, since the noise, thermal noise, is due to the random motion of electrons in the device, we want to make this random motion as slow or as small as possible. And this implies cooling the device, cooling the device as much as possible. Okay, so the low noise amplifier, all the electronics of the low noise amplifier is cryogenically cooled at helium temperature, if liquid helium temperature if possible, or surely nitrogen, liquid nitrogen temperature, but even below that. And by cryogenically cooling the electronics, the system noise temperature of the device, of the LNA, is something today, as I said, of the order of 18 Kelvin in at X band. And we are at 30 Kelvin at Ka band. But we are improving at Ka band. See, a band is, you see, would be very a great advantage in space telecommunication because the antenna gains are so much larger than at X band. But we have two drawbacks. One is that we are not yet able to have low noise amplifiers, which are at the same system noise temperature as X-band devices, first, and this means a loss of SNR. And the second thing is attenuation due to rain attenuation or weather due to water vapor, which also is a drawback. And if you remember, there was. If you remember when we I showed the curve of the attenuation as a function of frequency for the Earth atmosphere, there was a dip at 32-34 GHz, but the dip in any case entailed a reduction of 50% of the power on average. So there is a question on the chat. If we don't cool the device, ND would be of the same order of magnitude of the input noise. Well, yes, if we don't cool ND, you would get an equivalent noise temperature. So TE would be of the order, let us say, of 300 Kelvin, or even more, because it's not the physical temperature alone which matters. So you would lose immediately from 30 to 300, you would lose immediately 10 dB in signal-to-noise ratio if you don't cool the device. And therefore, also the bit rate, as we have seen on Thursday, would immediately decrease by the same amount because the energy per bit would, of course, needs to be increased by a factor of 10 in order to keep the same bit error rate. Okay? So please confirm on the chat that this is understood. So one uses also to characterize an amplifier another parameter which may be of some interest. It's called the figure of merit. And the figure of merit is a ratio, is a dimensionless quantity, which is the ratio of the output noise power, the true output noise power, and the noise power that one would get if the receiver were noiseless, so ND equals zero. So this is the ratio, which you can write as 1 over ND over GKB T0 because we use a reference temperature which is 209 Kelvin to define the figure of merit. So we have an input corresponding to a noise temperature of 290 Kelvin and an output which is referred to the same temperature. So this is 1 plus TE over T0, and the noise figure is measured in dB. Okay? It's a dimensionless number, and is measured in dB. It tells us how good an amplifier is. So there can be multiple amplification stages, but I would not go through all this, and rather we start talking about the mathematical model for the spacecraft signal, which is an important topic. So, if you have questions on what we saw till now, please write on the chat, because now we switch gear and see how an antenna can measure Doppler range rate. Doppler and range rate are equivalently used, they indicate the same thing. Doppler is measured in millihertz or hertz, and range rate in meters or millimeters per second, but they are the same thing. So the observable quantities, if there are no question on the chat, I move forward. The observable quantities for orbit determination are obtained, of course, today by establishing radio links between the ground antenna and the spacecraft. So essentially, in the end, the ground antenna and the spacecraft exchange photons. Okay. The most accurate measurements are always obtained in a two-way system. That is a system where we have an uplink and a downlink which are coherent. One can use also laser beams. For example, the GPS satellites are also equipped with a laser retroreflector. A retroreflector is a device, is a corner cube, a piece of a cube. You cut a corner of a cube and you obtain a device which has the magic property of retransmitting back a light ray independently of its orientation. It can be demonstrated. So, laser time of flights are used also for orbit determination, for example, of GPS satellites. But if you are going a little bit farther away, for example, to the moon, it's already difficult to, it's not easy to obtain an echo unless you know exactly where the reflector is. So laser ranging is mostly used for terrestrial satellites. For interplanetary missions, exploration of the solar system, one has to rely on radio signals, and terrestrial satellites do exactly the same. Of course, if the satellites are below the GPS or GNSS system altitudes, they can do orbit determination by exploiting the GNSS signals. But as we said, our goal is not to tell you how to do navigation using GPSS, GNSS, GPS signals. That's easy. But to be able to maintain a GNSS system, which entails determining the orbits of all these satellites. So, radiometric measurements are obtained in three steps. The first step is to send a signal from the ground antenna to the spacecraft, let us say at time T1. After some time, depends on how far the satellite is, can be 1 millisecond if the satellite is above our head, or can be several hours for a probe in the far reaches of the solar system. This signal is received, and let us call this time the reception time on board T2. The signal which is received is retransmitted coherently to ground. Okay. And I emphasize the word coherence. Coherence means that there is no phase loss on board. The phase is in a known, the outgoing phase is in a known or fixed relationship with the phase of the received signal. So it's retransmitted back to ground at time T2. There may on board a short latency time due to the electronics, which may be taken into account. And finally, the signal is received by the ground antenna, let us say at time T3. Okay? So these are the basic, the participating events in the measurement. Phase coherence on board the spacecraft, which is crucial, is enabled by the transponder. So the transponder is really the heart of the onboard telecommunication system. Phase coherence on the ground antenna, phase coherence between the transmitting and the receiving chain, is enabled by the master frequency standard of the ground antenna, which also stays at the heart of the ground antenna. Because all the signals, all the mixing stages in the uplink and downlink, they are all referred to the master frequency standard. Now, this is the configuration of a two-way radio link. If we have one-way radio link, and for the sake of simplicity, we will analyze first one-way radio links. One-way radio links can be considered as a one leg of a two-way link. Okay, now let us look at this important plot. In this plot, I have shown the world line of the spacecraft and the ground station. So let us learn how to read this diagram. So on the x-axis we have time. Counted by, measured by the master frequency standard of the ground antenna, the ground antenna clock. And this is why we emphasize so much clocks, if you remember, at the end of the first part of this course. In the y-axis, we have plotted space. Space is in unity, in units of speed of light. So the path of a photon which travels at the speed of light with these units is a line inclined at 45 degrees on the x-axis, on the time axis. Okay? The spacecraft here has a very much lower velocity than light, so v is much smaller than the speed of light. Therefore, its space in space, it will move slowly at an angle which is very small with respect to the x-axis, the time axis. The velocity of the spacecraft in this diagram is given by the tangent, okay, the tangent to the world line at a given point. And since the velocity is smaller, the angle with the t-axis must also be small. Photons are much faster than the spacecraft. Let me take the eraser pen and erase everything. Okay. I need to do. Okay. So the three participating events are T1. So this is the world line of the ground antenna. We reference everything to the ground antenna. We suppose the ground antenna is fixed. Its coordinate, space coordinate don't change. Only the time coordinate changes. The signal is transmitted at time T1 toward the spacecraft, while the photon moves toward the spacecraft. The spacecraft, which initially may have been here, I'm exaggerating, okay, is moving along this line, its world line, and the spacecraft is reached by the photon transmitted by the ground antenna at time T2. Okay? Then the photon is retransmitted back. And of course, also the ground antenna moves while the photon is propagating. And we have a reception at time T3. T3 minus T1 is the so-called round-trip light time. Okay? Round-trip light time. That is the time that a photon takes to go from the antenna to the spacecraft and back. And this is a fundamental observable for orbit determination. How much time a photon takes to go back and forth to the spacecraft? Of course, the round-trip light time is not really a distance. It's not a physical distance of the spacecraft with respect to the ground antenna at a specific time, because you have to remember that the spacecraft is moving while the photons are propagating. Okay? Can be 1 millisecond, but 1 millisecond for an Earth orbiting satellite is still 7 meters. If the satellite is farther away, 3,000 kilometers, it would be, of course, 10 milliseconds. And therefore, roughly, let us say, something on the order of tens of meters. But it's moving. And therefore, when we speak of range, and in homework one, for example, we gave you range and range rate. Range was provided assuming that radio signal would propagate at infinite velocity, which is not for the case. Okay? Which is not for the case. So we have to take into account that everything is moving while the photons are propagating. In addition, in order to make a precise work in the computation of the light time, so the computed observables, one has to take into account also relativistic effects. The propagation time is not does not include Euclidean terms only. The metrical space-time is not flat, we have learned, and one has to take into account the delays introduced by gravity. It's impossible to create an observable model which is accurate without including relativistic effects. And you see here in this slide, which I added, so it's not in the material that you have, the basics elements of, I summarized here the basic elements of a tracking system, a radiometric tracking system. So we have the uplinks. The downlinks, for example, this is the configuration used by Bepi Colombo, which is probably the most, which has probably the most advanced space telecommunication system, deep space telecommunication system, with two uplinks at X band and Ka band, and three downlink at X band and two Ka band, one coherent with X band and the other coherent with the Ka band uplink. So there will be five frequencies in the sky when Bepi Colombo is tracked. There is a Ka band transponder, an X band transponder standard, and this radio system will be able, go down directly to the final accuracy of the two-way system. In terms of range rate, here we are at about 3 microns per second at 1000 second integration time, and from two, let us say, even better, we have obtained also 7 millimeters in one pass, but let us say from two to about 2 centimeters with just 10 second integration time. So a very accurate radio tracking system. And we will show how these measurements are done. Okay. The onboard configuration, also this is important for Bepi Colombo, entails essentially two sections. One which is used for navigation and TT&C, which is this part with the white blocks. So we have a 7.2 GHz signal coming in from the ground antenna. Of course, all these numbers are approximate because we have Doppler shifts, etc. The DST, Deep Space Transponder. DST is an acronym for Deep Space Transponder. Receives the signal and coherently generates an 8.4 GHz signal and a 32.5 GHz signal, coherent with the uplink. This signal is fed into two amplifiers. One at X band and one at Ka band, they are separate. And remember, all this part in white is redundant. So there are two of them, there are two DSTs, two X band traveling wave to tube amplifier. TWTA stands for traveling wave tube amplifier, is a type of amplifier that is very common for space applications. All this is redundant. Why? because the telecommunication system is a vital system of the spacecraft, so we cannot afford a failure. If the DST would fail, or the KAA band TWTA would fail, of course the entire mission would be in jeopardy. If the DST fails, of course the mission ends. So all this is redundant. And this function is part of the standard telecommunication system. In addition, we have for scientific experiment a Ka band transponder which receives a 34.3 GHz and outputs a coherent 32.5 GHz. It has this device as a solid state amplifier built in. So the unit includes also the solid state amplifier. This unit enables a much more precise Doppler and range measurement than the standard TTNC system, and is done as part of a science experiment of which I am the principal investigator. So far, the system, this unit, which has been built by Thales Alenia Space here in Rome and L'Aquila, works in an exquisite way, gave results which are simply fantastic. I mentioned to you 2-3 centimeters in range accuracy. So we obtained from the initial tests outstanding results. And it will be used for measuring gravity fields, the gravity field of Mercury, and to carry out tests of general relativity and in general relativistic gravity. This is not redundant. It's a science experiment. If the KAT fails, the mission would not be in jeopardy, so there is no need to have a redundant instrument. In general, the payload, if it's non-essential, and all the scientific instrument payload are considered as non-essential in a mission, they are not redundant. Okay? So we have only 3 minutes to go, and time just to introduce the mathematical model that we will work on tomorrow. So we will consider first a one-way link, a simple case. To write the equation for a two-way link, you have just to add additional terms. So we consider a signal emitted by the spacecraft by an oscillator, can be an ultra-stable oscillator or a clock, and the signal emitted by the spacecraft, as in our case can be an electric field, has this mathematical form. So for me is the real part of an amplitude factor S0 times a complex exponential at frequency omega 0 and arbitrary initial phase F0, phi 0. So in the spacecraft frame, omega 0 is constant, okay, no Doppler shift. The phase is an arbitrary phase, and S0 also is a constant, but this doesn't matter much, is provided by the onboard traveling wave 2 tube amplifier, but by, let us say, the onboard amplifier in general. So the larger the amplifier power, the larger will be S0. Okay? So this is the transmitted signal. Of course, on board, we cannot have very good clocks. So when I say omega 0 is constant, is constant within the limits of the clock that is used to generate it. So we can write that omega zero in general is equal to an average frequency, this omega zero in brackets, plus a jitter delta omega. Okay? So there will be always a noise, especially because on board you cannot have in general hydrogen masers or very stable clocks because of limitations in mass and power. But for the time being, we will assume that omega zero is a constant. Okay? And we will see the mathematical model of the signal next time, because we have finished. It's known, and I have to start soon the space environment class. So again, if there are quick questions, please go ahead. I will wait for a couple of minutes, and otherwise I will stop the streaming and we'll meet you again tomorrow. So I remember to the space environment students who may have signed in that I will stop streaming and will restart streaming in order to separate the two lectures. I'm forced to do so because I was not able to create two different streams. Okay, I wait another minute and then I will stop streaming and restart for the space environment class. All right, so we can stop here. Stop streaming. And we'll restart the streaming shortly for the Space Environment class. Goodbye to everyone.